Welcome to Newsmax TV. I'm Kathleen Walter. Joining us is a very special guest, former House Speaker and possible GOP presidential candidate, Newt Gingrich. He is out with a new book, Valley Forge, co-written by William Fortune. It is a novelized version of the struggle of George Washington and his Continental Army to survive the bitter winter of 1777. A fascinating read, Mr. Speaker. Before we get to the book, I do want to get your thoughts on some big developing stories from this week, starting with the verdict in the first civil trial of a Gitmo terror detainee. Not guilty on all but one of the charges relating to the deadly bombings of U.S. embassies in Africa. In your view, was justice served?
No. It's clear to me that Attorney General Holder should resign, that his rulings have been wrong, that they have endangered national security. They allowed a federal judge to throw out most of the evidence. It's fundamentally wrong to go into a civil court on this kind of, basically, this is a fight over a war. And you can't bring into this kind of trial the kind of evidence that a military tribunal would have. And the federal judge was wrong, and the Attorney General was wrong to take it there. So I think Attorney General Holder should resign, and I think the American people should rightly feel that they are more endangered as long as Holder is the Attorney General.
What effect does this have on the Obama administration's plans to try accused terrorists in civilian courts versus military tribunals?
Well, I think it's further proof that their whole approach to it is just profoundly wrong. They refuse to admit that we're in a war. In fact, my wife, Calista, and I made a movie called America at Risk, The War with No Name. And we outlined there vividly how much they deny reality. And I think it's very dangerous to have an administration which refuses to deal with reality.
Now to airport security and the public outcry over screening passengers with nude body scanners or intimate pat-downs. What is your take on all of this?
You know, I think it is tragic that the Obama administration refuses to tell us the truth about our enemies, refuses to design a strategy to defeat our enemies, and instead believes that inconveniencing, embarrassing, humiliating millions of innocent people is better than profiling, better than aggressive intelligence, better than the kind of things we ought to be doing to stop the bad guys. I think this is a grotesque overreach of government, and I think that it is profoundly wrong.
Should we be conducting profiling in our nation's airports?
Absolutely. I mean, and the profiling is not ethnic. The profiling is probable cause. I mean, if you said to me, if you had somebody you genuinely had probable cause, should you thoroughly inspect them? Sure. But if you don't have probable cause, the idea that every innocent person who mathematically or mechanically ends up with TSA is going to have this kind of treatment is just profoundly wrong.
Incoming Speaker John Boehner and Republicans are taking a hard line on federal spending, but should they risk a 1995-style government shutdown?
Well, they should say that they want to do everything they can to keep the government open, except cave in to President Obama. And then it's President Obama's choice. I mean, if he wants to force a shutdown, I don't see that they can give him a tax increase to avoid it or giant spending to avoid it. They just need to make sure the country understands that a shutdown won't occur because Republicans are trying to. The shutdown would occur because the president, in fact, was deliberately manipulating the system.
Now, in the wake of big midterm losses for Democrats, how should President Obama lead moving forward? And do you think that he is capable of a Clinton-esque triangulation to the center?
I think it's much harder for President Obama to move to the center because under pressure from the Tea Parties and under pressure from the American people, the center is moving to the right pretty dramatically. This country wants much, much less spending than President Obama, much lower taxes than President Obama, much less bureaucracy than President Obama, much less power in Washington than President Obama. So for him to try to compromise means he will in effect have to repudiate himself on a scale that President Clinton never considered.
Do you see President Obama facing a primary challenge in 2012, perhaps, say, from Secretary of State Clinton?
Well, I sort of doubt if she would run against him just because she's in the cabinet. They have a daily working relationship. That'd be a pretty big jump psychologically. But I can imagine somebody, particularly on the left, running against him. And then if he ends up being wounded, as Lyndon Johnson was by Gene McCarthy, then I could imagine Secretary Clinton being drawn in once it was an open race.
Let's talk about your book, Valley Forge. It describes a year of triumph and tribulation for George Washington at the time of the Revolutionary War. How do you bring history to life in the novel?
Well, we try to, first of all, the reason we use the novel is to make it a story, to make it exciting, to try to get you wanting to turn the next page, wanting to know what's going to happen. And I believe that approach is makes history come alive. We also try to give you some sense of what the real struggle was and all the human sides of that struggle, the ambitions, the concerns, the exhaustion, and the relationship between George and Martha, and the degree to which Martha Washington's willingness to come to Valley Forge from February through June was a significant part of George Washington's strength.
Do you see any parallels between that defining time in American history and today?
I see a really big parallel because Washington was a person who could face the facts, and he was a person who could change things to meet reality. And I think that we're in a period where we have to face facts about America's future, face facts about our economic competition, face facts about the people who want to kill us. And I think Washington would have told us that there are times when a free society has to be very mature and has to have a serious adult conversation, and then has to make difficult decisions and carry them out. Remember, he spends 8 years in the field from 1775 to 1783 and only goes home to Valley Forge for 2 weeks in that 8 year period. I think he would tell us we better roll up our sleeves and get our house put in order, and we better fix things rather than lie about them.
The book tour includes stops in Iowa and South Carolina, two very important early voting states in the presidential primary calendar. Any update on your thoughts about running for the White House?
I think we have to move from a rejection conservatism, which is anti-left, to a replacement conservatism, which brings together the vast majority of the American people and creates a new, more positive governing system than we've inherited over the last 80 years. And I think to do that, to have smaller government in Washington, more decentralization, to have the 10th Amendment implemented, to lower your taxes but increase your responsibility as a citizen, is going to require a national movement. At American Solutions, we've worked very hard to develop that movement at the state and local level. If that develops, and if Calista and I can see our way clear to do it, I suspect next February or March we'll make a decision and probably announce in March or April. But I think that our concern for the moment is to focus on laying the groundwork for a movement and then to look at our own personal situation. I think it's really important for America that we set ourselves on a new path, a path of working, saving, investing, being honest about what we have to do, both economically and in national security, and reestablishing American exceptionalism, the notion that we are a unique country endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. And I think that's the big challenge of our generation.
Former Alaska Governor Sarah Palin says that she thinks that she could beat President Obama in 2012. Do you think she can? And could you?
I think the Republican nominee will be able to beat President Obama. I think President Obama will be a one-term president. And whether it's Governor Palin or Governor Huckabee or Governor Romney or Governor Mitch Daniels or Governor Tim Pawlenty or Senator John Thune or Governor Haley Barbour or Senator Rick Santorum or Newt Gingrich, I suspect that the Republican nominee, the person who gets through this process, who can answer the questions, withstand the pressure, organize the resources, that person, I think, will be capable of defeating President Obama. But more importantly, I think they'll be capable of bringing together 60 or 65% of the American people to create a vast majority for a newer, better approach to solving America's problems.
Mr. Speaker, thanks so much for your time. You. Again, the book is called Valley Forge. It's a fantastic read. If folks want to learn more about you and about the book, where can they go?
Probably the easiest place is to go to my first name, newt.org.
All right, Mr. Speaker, thank you.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for watching Newsmax TV.